Hello everyone, I am Neeru and today we will be doing SSC CGL Tier 1 paper. This paper is on the tougher side, it's on the higher level and it's according to the new pattern which has been given by SSC. The paper code is 1102. I will be doing the general awareness section with you. I will be doing the general awareness section from question number 26 to question number 50 and I'll give you detailed explanations for each and every question. Let's begin paper code 1102. Question number 26. Question number 26. In the Sultanate period, the Diwan-e-Ishtikya was the department of. What was it the department of? This question is from medieval India. Question is from medieval India and there were many departments in the medieval period. There was a department of pensions, military department, finance department, a department for slaves, a department for construction of buildings, etc. And these are the names of all the departments which you can see here. There is Diwan-e-Risalat. Diwan-e-Risalat, it was the department of appeals. We have Diwan-e-Arz, the military department. The military department was separated from the finance department by Balban. Diwan-e-Bandgan, this was the department of slaves and it was very important in the time of Firoz Shah Tughlaq because the ruler loved slaves and he had around 180,000 slaves and these slaves had to be put under a separate department. Then we have Diwan-e-Qasa-e-Mumalik. That is the Department of Justice. Diwan-e-Ishtikya, which you have been given in the question, that is the Department of Pensions. Mustakhraj, Department of Arrears. Diwan-e-Khairiyat. Diwan-e-Khairiyat looked after unemployed youth. It gave them employment. It looked after the old, the sick, etc. It was the Department for Charity. Diwan-e-Kohi, this was the Department of Agriculture. And Diwan-e-Insha, the Department for Correspondence. So, for question number 26, in the Sultanate period, it was the Department of Pensions, which was known as Diwan-e-Ishtikya. Answer is for question number 26, A. Question number 27. Which of the following coasts generally remains dry during the months of July and August? Now, in the month of July and August, it's going to be monsoon season all over India. But there is a certain coast which remains dry. Now, this is southern India. Okay. Here, this side, this is the western side, this is the eastern side. Now, we're talking, this side will have the eastern coast and the western coast. Coromandel coast, Konkan coast, Malabar coast and we have northern Sarkars. The upper portion of the eastern coast is known as the northern Sarkars and as you go down, you are going to find here the Coromandel coast in Tamil Nadu region. On the western side, you will have on the upper, you will have the Kathiawar Peninsula. Then as you go down, you will find the Konkan coast and finally the Malabar coast. Malabar coast is in Kerala. Now, the Coromandel coast, it falls in the rain shadow of the Western Ghats. Here you will also have the Western Ghats. The mountains are going to be here parallel Western Ghats. And as we go towards the south, the Western Ghats increase in their height. And the Coromandel coast, which lies on the other side, it lies in the rain shadow area of the Western Ghats. The Western Ghats do not allow the moisture bearing winds to cross this side and it does not allow it to go towards Tamil Nadu. That is the region that the Coromandel coast does not receive any rain during the monsoon season. It receives rain in the winter months. Tamil Nadu is a state which receives rain during the winter months of November and December from retreating monsoon. So, question number 27, which of the following coasts generally remains dry during the months of July and August? The Coromandel coast falls in the rain shadow of the Western Ghats and receives less rainfall during summer southwest monsoon, which contributes heavily to rainfall in the rest of India. Question number 28, next one. The previous one was related to physical geography of India. This is also related to the physical geography of India. Physical geography of India. Now, what is the question? Let's take a look at that. Arrange the following from west to east. Garo, Jaintia, Khasi and Patkaibam. These are the hills. These are the hills of the northeast. These are the hills of the northeast. And we have to arrange them from west to east. That means from we have to arrange them from in this direction, which is the westernmost and the easternmost. Now, let me show you this picture. Here we have Garo. First we have Garo, G-A-R-O, Garo. Here you can see Garo. Then we have Khasi. Then we have Jaintia Hills. And here we have, these are the Patkaibam Hills. So if we arrange them from west to east, then we are going to go in which direction? We'll go with Garo, then Khasi, then Jaintia and Patkaimam. So we have GK, Garo, Khasi. Okay. So where is this order? The order is here. Number one, Garo. In B, Garo, Khasi. Then we have after Garo, then we have Khasi, then Jaintia and Patkaimam. Answer is B. Question number 28. Answer is B. Question number 29. Morgan and Nahar Katia are famous for. Morgan and Nahar Katia are famous for what? Now, Nahar Katia, it's a town area which is in Dibrugarh district. Dibrugarh district, this is in Assam. It is in the state of Assam and it is very, very well known for petroleum and gas reserves. So, both these places, they are famous for oil. Question number 29, my answer is C. Question number 29, answer is C. 30, what is oil zapping? Oil zapping, this question is from biodiversity. These days you are given a lot of questions on biodiversity, ecological balance, etc. This question is related to that. What is oil zapping? Exactly that is being asked. It is using bacteria to get rid of oil spill. It is negative impact of oil spill on the wings of marine birds. It's oil spill in the ocean preventing sunlight from penetrating and thus affecting the photosynthesis in phytoplanktons, or is it none of these? The answer for question number 30 is A. It is using bacteria to get rid of oil spill. Oil spill is a major problem in the oceans. Ships carry oil and if there's any kind of leakage, the oil spills all over air in the ocean and oil will create a thick layer on the top and it will prevent oxygen from going within. So it creates a lot of problems and now a environment friendly technique has been introduced which is known as oil zapping. Now let us see what is this oil zapping. What is oil zapping? Oil zapping, it's a new technique using bacteria to get rid of oil spill and this technique is known as oil zapping. This technique is going to be known as oil zapping. It is a bioremediation technique involving the use of oil zapping bacteria. And how does this work? Firstly, there are five different bacterial strains and these strains are immobilized. And after that, they are mixed with a carrier material known as powdered concob. And this mixture of five bacteria in powdered concob, this is known as oil zapper. And wherever the oil has spilled in the ocean, this bacteria is going to work there. Oil zapper, it feeds on the hydrocarbon compounds which are present in the crude oil and the dangerous hydrocarbon waste generated by oil refineries, which is known as oil sludge. And after that, when it feeds on this crude oil or the oil sludge, it converts it into harmless carbon dioxide and water. And this way, we are able to get rid of the oil spill. Oil zapper is neatly packed into sterile polythene bags and sealed aseptically for safe transport. And the shelf life of the product is 3 months at ambient temperature. And this technique, it came into limelight in the year 2010 when there was oil spill on the Bombay coast and this technique was adapted and it proved to be very, very successful. The technique was used successfully and 130,000 tons of oil sludge contaminated oil was treated as per the leading news sources in the year 2010. So, very nice news. If there is oil spill, we have a bioremediation technique to cure it. Question number 31. Question number 31. Which was the first disease to be completely eradicated by the efforts of who? Question number 31. Answer is smallpox. Smallpox was officially declared eradicated in 1980 and it was the first disease to have been fought on a global scale. And what is smallpox? Smallpox is a very, very dangerous disease. It's a highly contagious and often life-threatening infection. And in this, there are rashes all over the body on face, arms and legs. And if you scratch them, they're going to leave behind a mark. And variola virus causes it. This is also important. And due to the efforts of WHO, World Health Organization, in the year 1980, we were able to get rid of it. The world became free from it. Question number 31. Question number 32. Question number 32. Shariki dynasty ruled over which of the following? Shariki dynasty. Shariki dynasty ruled over Jaunpur. Jaunpur is in current day UP. The Jaunpur Sultanate, this was an independent kingdom of northern India, and in the time period 1394 to 1479, whose rulers ruled from Jaunpur in the present state of UP, Jaunpur Sultanate was ruled by Shariki dynasty. The Khwaja-e-Jahan Malik Sarwar was the first ruler, and it was on his surname that this dynasty ruled. Adopted the surname. He was earlier a minister under a Sultan Nasiruddin Muhammad Shah IV Tughlaq, and in 1394 he established himself an independent ruler of Jaunpur, and he extended his authority over Awadh. Awadh is present day Lucknow and a large part of Ganga Yamuna Doab. Doab means the area between these two rivers. The dynasty founded by him was named so because of his title Malik-ush-Sharz, or the ruler of the east. Now, the most acclaimed ruler of this dynasty was Ibrahim Shah, and the last ruler Hussein Shah was overthrown by Behlol Lodi, and Jaunpur was finally permanently annexed into the Delhi Sultanate by Sikandar Lodi. You should remember a few things about Jaunpur. Firstly, it is known as Shiraz of the East. Sometimes you are given a question as to which of the following places was called Shiraz of the East. Answer is Jaunpur, because of the educated and intellectual men of this place. You must have heard the name of Malik Muhammad Jaisi. Malik Muhammad Jaisi. He is a very famous writer who has written the book Padmavat. Padmavat and Malik Muhammad Jaisi belonged to Jaunpur. Padmavat is the name of his book, and it is the story of Queen Padmini, who was a queen who performed Johar. Okay, you can be given a question as to what is known as Shiraz of the East. The answer is Jaunpur. Which dynasty ruled over Jaunpur? It was the Shariki dynasty that ruled there. Malik Muhammad Jaisi, who has written Padmavat, belonged to which place? He belonged to Jaunpur. And Malik Muhammad Jaisi has written which book? He has written the book Padmavat about Queen Padmini and the desire of Alauddin Khilji to marry her or to. And then finally, this queen had performed Johar in the beginning, sometime around the year 1301. Question number 32. Question number 33. Which of the following clouds give a halo effect to the sun or the moon? Now, what is the halo effect? Halo effect is this: when you see a kind of an illumination behind the sun or the moon, when you see an illumination, that is known as the halo effect. My answers are cirrocumulus clouds, cirrostratus clouds, stratus clouds, or altocumulus clouds. Now, when does this happen? See, the higher a cloud is going to be formed, the chances are that it is going to be formed of ice, because at a high altitude, the temperature is going to be low. When the temperature is going to be low, the water is going to freeze into ice, and from these ice crystals we will see the moon. Therefore, this halo effect will be given. Okay. So, which of the following cloud gives a halo effect to the sun or moon? What is firstly halo? Halo is an optical phenomena produced by light interacting with ice crystals suspended in the atmosphere, resulting in a wide variety of colored and white ring around it. The cirrus or the cirrostratus clouds, the cirrus which are formed at 5 to 10 kilometer in the upper atmosphere, they give this halo effect. So, my answer is B, cirrostratus. Next is question number 34. In the Sultanate period, a land tax equal to 1/10 of the produce of land was. Question number 34. This is my question. Now, here there are four kind of taxes mentioned. Now we have Kharaj, Jazia, Zakat and Khamas. These are the four kind of taxes which are mentioned. Kharaj, Jazia, Zakat and Khamas. Islamic taxes are taxes which are sanctioned by Islamic law. What is Zakat? Zakat is one of the five pillars of Islam, in which the Muslims are generally supposed to donate 2.5% of their savings for charity for the poor and the needy. Sometimes you are even given a question as to which of the following taxes was to be paid only by Muslims. That is Zakat. Sikhism and Islam focuses a lot and it lays stress on donations and charity. What was Jizya? Jizya was a tax which was levied by the Islamic State on non-Muslims, and the non-Muslims were known as Zimmis. These Zimmis were supposed to pay the tax as protection money, and this tax was not supposed to be paid by poor, women, children, elderly, handicapped, etc. What was Kharaj? Kharaj was a land tax at first imposed only on non-Muslims, which was later imposed on Muslims as well. And what is Khamas? Khamas was a share in the booty. A share in the booty that was known as Khamas. Question number 34. In the Sultanat period, a land tax equal to 1/10 of the produce of the land was. Question number 34. Answer is going to be A. Question number 34. Answer is. So for question number 34, answer is going to be A, Kharaj. 34, question number 34, Kharaj is my answer. Let's move on to question number 35. Question number 35, in case of Griffin goods like Bajra, a fall in its price tends to. What are Griffin goods? First, let us understand that this is a question of economics. A Griffin good is a product that people consume more of as the price rises and vice versa, violating the law of demand. That is known as a Griffin good. Now, in economics, an inferior good is a good that decreases in demand when consumer income rises. When the income of the consumer is going to increase, he will not buy an inferior good, he will go for another good. Or rises in demand when the consumer income decreases, unlike normal goods, for which the opposite is observed. Normal goods are those for which consumers' demand increases when the income increases. This would be the opposite of a superior good. For question number 35, my answer is B. In case of Griffin goods like Bajra, a fall in its price tends to reduce the demand. Question number 35, answer is B. Next is question number 36. Monzeret and Aquiva were sent to Akbar's court by. The name of these two persons are important because in Akbar had built an Ibadat Khana. He had built an Ibadat Khana at Fatehpur Sikri in Agra because he wanted to know what exactly is the true religion. And for this, Akbar built a religious building known as Ibadat Khana. He wanted to know why there are so many fights between people of different communities, etc. And in this Ibadat Khana, he invited everybody to come and express his opinion, different religious leaders. He even called atheists to know why they were atheists. And here, he discussed Christianity with these two men. These are their names, and these two were sent to Akbar's court by the Portuguese. So for question number 36, my answer is going to be D, Portuguese. Question number 37. Economics planning by direction is an integral part of. Economics planning by direction is an integral part of what? It is an integral part of socialist economy. Planning by direction is an integral part of a socialist society. It assumes complete absence of laissez-faire. Therefore, it implies complete centralized planning, no features of private economy. Question number 37. My answer is C. When there is planning by direction, the planning authority takes charge of the productive resources and uses them in accordance with social priorities. Question number 38. Question number 38. The parliament under dash can increase or decrease the area of any state or alter the boundaries or change the name of any state with a simple majority. So this is a question of polity in which it has been asked as to under which article can the parliament increase or decrease the area of any state or change the boundaries. This is all laid down in Article 3. It is all laid down in Article 3, and what is there in Article 3? Let me tell you that. Now, for the formation of a new state or altering of areas, boundaries or names of existing state, the parliament may by law form a new state by separation of territory from any state or by uniting two or more state or parts of state or by uniting any territory to a part of any state. The parliament can increase the area of a state, it can diminish the area of a state, it can alter the boundaries, alter the name of the state. In this, it is the parliament which is supreme and the concerned state will not really have any real powers. This was the question related to polity. Economics, we have another question from economics. Thomas Malthus believed. What did Thomas Malthus believe? Now, let us see that. Thomas Malthus believed that the population of a country will always increase. He believed that production cannot keep on increasing. Food supplies place a limit to the growth of population. And D, population increase leads to fall in output. This is my question, question number 39. Now, question number 39, answer is C, food supplies limit to the growth of population. Question number 39, Malthus is very, very famous, and what did he say in 1798? Let's take a look at that. In an essay on the principle of population, Thomas Malthus examined the relationship between two things, population growth and resources. And he gave a new theory known as Malthusian theory of population growth. And he laid down that population growth occurs exponentially, so it increases according to birth rate. In, if I tell you in a layman's language, he said that if the population continues to increase this way, there will be a day when the people will not have anything to eat because food production is limited, land is limited. For example, if every member of a family tree reproduces, the tree will continue to grow with each generation. On the other hand, food production increases arithmetically, so it only increases at given points in time. This was what he said. Question number 40. Which of the following lakes is incorrectly matched with the state in which they are located? Which of the following lakes is incorrectly matched with the state in which they are located? Deeporbil, Assam, Lake Cholamu, Meghalaya, Wooler, JNK, Pulikat Lake in Tamil Nadu. Question number 40. Question number 40, my answer is going to be B. My Lake Cholamu is incorrectly matched with Meghalaya. It lies in Sikkim. Let us read about Lake Cholamu. It's called Lake Cholamu. It is one of the highest lakes in the world, and it is located at a height of 5,330 meters, and it is located in North Sikkim, just 4 kilometers southwest of the Chinese border. Question from geography. Sides of a matchbox is coated with a paste of. What are the sides of a matchbox coated with? What are they coated with? The answer is they are coated with red phosphorus, antimony sulfide and ground glass and gum. Question number 41. My answer is D. Question number 42. The next one. The rate of transpiration depends on. What does the rate of transpiration depend on? The rate of transpiration depends upon air, in light, on heat or all of the above. Now, what is transpiration? Transpiration is the loss of water from a plant in the form of water vapor. Now, this is my leaf, and behind the leaf there are going to be tiny openings known as stomata. And all the water that has been absorbed by the roots of the plant, etc., the leaf is going to lose a major portion of that water through these tiny openings known as stomata. And this process is known as transpiration. Transpiration, it is the loss of water from a plant in the form of water vapor. Water is absorbed by roots from the soil and transported as a liquid to the leaves via xylem. In the leaves, the small pores allow water to escape as vapor. Now, obviously, if the wind is blowing, whatever water is being given out by the leaf, that will be transported away from there. If there is excess of light, there is going to be more transpiration. If there is excess of heat, if there is heat, it causes evaporation and all this. So, question number 42, answer is going to be D, all of the above. Question number 42, answer is D. Question number 43, which of the following is not a gland? My options are thyroid, stomach, liver and pancreas. Now, what is a gland? A gland is an organ in the human or animal body which secretes a particular chemical substance. That is known as a gland. Out of these, only the stomach is not a gland. Only the stomach is not a gland. Question number 43. Question number 44, a question related to polity. Which of the following is not covered under the directive principles of state policy? The living wages for workers. What are living wages? Living wages are those minimum wages which should be given to him so that he can live a decent life. Equal pay for equal work, abolition of untouchability or free legal aid. These are the options available. Which of the following is not covered under the directive principles of state policy? Abolition of untouchability has not been covered under directive principles of state policy. And now let us discuss what are directive principles of state policy and what is abolition of untouchability. What are the directive principles of state policy? The directive principles of state policy are in part 4 of the constitution, and these are guidelines or principles which have been laid down for the central or state government of India, and these should be kept in mind while framing any kind of laws and policies. These are not enforceable in any court of law, and that is what distinguishes them from fundamental rights. But the principles laid down therein are considered fundamental in the governance of the country, making it the duty of the state to apply these principles in making laws to establish a just society in the country. The principles have been inspired by directive principles. You can even be given a question as to from where have the directive principles of state policy been taken. They have been taken from Ireland. Many important things about directive principles of state policy here. Firstly, they are in part 4 of the constitution. Please remember them. Are they enforceable in any court of law? They are not. They are guidelines for central and state government. Okay. Then, and they have been taken from the constitution of Ireland. Now, abolition of untouchability is a fundamental right. Abolition of untouchability is a fundamental right which has been covered under fundamental rights. It has been covered under fundamental rights. Now, what is abolition of untouchability? Now, abolition of untouchability has been covered under the fundamental rights, and the fundamental rights are in part 3 of the constitution. And Article 17 abolishes untouchability, and besides, the parliament has also passed Untouchability Offences Act of 1955. It came into force in the year, in the same year, in 1955, and it was further amended and renamed as the 1976, in 1976 as Protection of Civil Rights Act. And the act lays down that whatever is open to general public should be open to the members of the scheduled caste also. In fact, all public places now have been opened to all the members. Earlier, the SC and STs were not allowed. So, abolition of untouchability has been talked about in detail in Article 17, and it has been abolished. Question number 45. Which one of the following is used to restore the color of old oil paintings? A question from chemistry. Which one of the following is used to restore the color of old oil paintings? My options are ozone, hydrogen peroxide, barium peroxide, or sodium peroxide. Question number 45. Now let us see about question number 45. My answer is hydrogen peroxide. See, it is given here. Under proper conditions, hydrogen peroxide changes black into white. And you can demonstrate this by soaking a sheet of paper in a solution of lead acetate and then holding the sheet in the fumes of hydrogen sulfide generated by pouring a little dilute sulfuric acid on a few grains of iron sulfide in a test tube. Let the paper dry after it has become completely black, then paint over the black surface with a brush dipped in peroxide. The black turns white. And this experiment shows why hydrogen peroxide will restore the brightness of white lead paint. Such paint often turns dark because hydrogen sulfide in the air reacts with it, producing black lead sulfide. And it is this property, it is this principle which is used in to brighten old oil paintings. Because in oil paintings, there is going to be lead. So, this was the answer. Question number 46, physics. A question from physics. Why does bleeding occur through the nose in high mountainous regions? Now, there is something called atmospheric pressure. This atmospheric pressure is exerted on our body. Suppose this is me. Atmospheric pressure is going to be exerted in my body. But there are fluids and gases in my body which exert an equal amount of pressure which works outwards. And this atmospheric pressure is on my body. So, the outward pressure and the internal pressure, both of them balance each other. Both of them are going to balance each other. Now, what happens in mountainous regions that these two counter pressures, there is a counter pressure equal and opposite in our body with respect to the atmospheric pressure at normal altitude. But as we go higher, the atmospheric pressure is going to decrease with increasing altitude. Hence, as we move to higher altitudes, atmospheric pressure becomes less compared to the body pressure. Now, the pressure inside the body is more than the pressure outside the body. That is the reason that nose bleeding takes place. So, fluids from the body, when there is not an equal pressure to check them, flows outside the body. As human body takes some time to adjust to the atmospheric pressure, hence atmospheric pressure is the root cause of nose bleeding at high altitude. So for question number 46, my answer is C. Question number 46, my answer is going to... So for question number 46, my answer is going to be C. The blood pressure of a person increases at high altitudes. That is the answer. Question number 47. Let's take a look. Again, a question from physics. You get these kind of questions a lot these days as to why there is bleeding when one goes on a mountain. Why is food cooked faster? Or these kind of questions you get. So now let's see question number 47. The reason for a swimming pool to appear less deep than the actual depth is, what is the reason? Now, this happens due to refraction. Let me explain to you what is refraction. Now, light travels in straight lines if it keeps traveling through the same medium. But what happens when light will move from a rarer to a denser medium or from a denser to a rarer medium? What is going to happen? Now, what will happen? That is known as refraction. What is refraction? Refraction, the rays of light coming from the pool travel from water to air. Now, this is water and they will go into the air. As the rays pass from denser, water was the dense medium, from the, now this is going to be the normal. They are going to move from a denser medium to a rarer medium. So, they will bend away from the normal. And when you extend this normal on either side where they meet, you will feel that the image is going to be formed here and you will feel it is at a higher level. As the rays pass from denser water to rarer medium, they bend away from the normal. When the rays are produced back, they form an image of the coin at the bottom of the pool at a point above the real position. Hence, the coin appears to be slightly raised and the pool appears to be less deep than it really is. And it is the same reason that when you see a fish swimming in water, it will appear to be at a higher level. When you see a coin placed at the bottom of a bucket, it will appear to be at a higher level. Question number 47, answer is A. Question number 48, Ace Against Odds, is an autobiography of. Who has written this book, Ace Against Odds? This book has been written by Sania Mirza recently. Sania Mirza, very, very famous in India, one of our most famous female athletes. She has written the book Ace Against Odds and it has been penned by Sania Mirza and her father Imran Mirza. Odds against, Ace Against Odds. Question number 49, Sohan Singh Barkhana. He is an Indian revolutionary whose name is associated to what? Sohan Singh Barkhana, his name has been associated to the Gadar Party. His name is associated to the Gadar Party. It was very, the party, this Gadar Party, it was a revolutionary movement and it was very, very famous in the, around the year 1913. So, what is, who is he? Let us see that. Baba Sohan Singh Barkhana, he was an Indian revolutionary and the founding president of the Gadar Party and a leading member of the party involved in the Gadar conspiracy of 1915, and these are his pictures. Last question to be done, question number 50, where are the headquarters of IMF? The headquarters of, MCF, Master Control Facility, which is the nerve center of the entire spacecraft operations in India, is located where? My options are Hyderabad, Thumpa, Sriharikota or Hassan. Question number 50. For question number 50, my answer is going to be D, Hassan in Karnataka. Now, let us see in detail. The Master Control Facility known as the MCF. This is a facility set up by Indian Space Research Organization, ISRO, and it is in the state of Karnataka. It was established in the year 1982. And this facility is responsible for monitoring and controlling geostationary and geosynchronous satellites launched by ISRO. And this was the only master control facility of ISRO. And after that, in 2005, we set up another one in Bhopal. So that is our answer, and this was the last question to be done. I wish you all the very, very best. Thank you.